rose-colored glasses are off, it's time to get real. Yet, we remain hopeful. Still, this is the Marketing Disenchanted Podcast. I am your host, Temitayo Osinubi. Let's get to it. Howdy, and welcome to episode 3 of the Marketing Disenchanted Podcast. So last episode, we were blessed with an awesome interview from Southern Methodist University professor James Loomstein, and he gave it to us raw, just like I like it, just like the name of the podcast would suggest, Disenchanted. And so this episode, I had the opportunity to interview a fellow Full Sail alum, Mr. Christopher Gaudreau. Chris, he's an inspiration. I mean, I'm not going to take too much in the pre-interview, but just suffice it to say that he's been through it, has a really inspiring journey, and now he's doing the damn thing full time like a lot of us aspire to. So without further ado, let's hop into our interview with fellow Full Sail alum Christopher Gaudreau. All right, thanks so much for joining me. I am joined by fellow Full Sail grad Christopher Gaudreau. Chris is living a dream for a lot of us, or at least living my dream, because he works from home full time for a legit digital marketing agency. So no rush hour traffic, just so he could go sit in a cube around a bunch of corporate ladder climbers who are shove a knife in your back and toss you under the bus to climb one rung on that ladder. Not for Mr. Gaudreau. No. He works from home full time. He is a subject matter expert who gets paid for his expertise. So Chris, thanks so much for joining me.
Thanks for that awesome introduction. And I don't know about living the dream, you know, for some people out there. It's not, you know, I'm not a millionaire or anything like that, but like you said, I mean, there's a lot to be said for I work from home, right? I don't have to go anywhere. I don't have to go into work. I still have to get up early and get my kids off to school, and my wife still works, and so that's kind of my next step is where I'm at, is I want to be able to bring my wife home from work as well. Then we could all be here and truly have that, the whole work from home thing. A lot of the goal, at least for me, was to be able to spend more time with the family. So now I'm here, but they're not here yet. So
exactly. Right. So we wish you luck with that. I know you're going to make it. So the road to where you've been, you know, tends to be a winding run. So, you know, tell us that story. Take us to that journey. How did you first become enchanted with digital marketing and, you know, lead you down this path?
Okay, so and I don't want this to be a 2-hour episode for you or anything, so I'm going to try to cut corners where I can. So it started for me in, I guess most of it started in 2010, but let me back up from there just a little bit, because right out of, it's hard not to tell you a whole life story in these kind of things, right out of high school, this is a long time ago now, right out of high school, I said, I got to get out of home. I got to leave home. I can't be here anymore. You know, like every teenager, right? And I went right to art school because I was like, I'm going to be an artist. I'm going to make tons of money and be an artist and all this. Went to art school. I decided instead I was going to party all the time and not get my homework in, and I just dropped out of that. Moved back home to be with the girlfriend, and I was a typical teenage entitlement sort of person, I guess. And I was like, I joined a band. This band is going to make it to the top. Right. And I sat around in the party atmosphere. I won't go into all the details, day in and day out, and I wasn't going anywhere. just fast forward a bit. I had never finished school. I had never really gotten anywhere. I worked at gas stations and kitchens and all that, and I got to a point where I cleaned up, and I said, okay, what am I going to do now? I was still working as a cook, and I decided to start a painting business, because I had just painted my apartment, and then I painted the apartment I was going to move into, because I was then engaged, so we painted where I was living with a roommate, and then I painted the next place where we were moving into after we got married. So I painted those, and I turned to my friend, my roommate at the time, and said, This is start a painting business. And I just jumped in. This was not my first time just jumping in, because I had, with that whole art thing, teamed up with my brother, who was even younger than I was. We joined the local Chamber of Commerce to provide website services. So this was late 90s, right? To have website services, this was the hot thing. Right. My brother was a web developer, and I was going to sell. I got clients for us. We did all right. Ultimately, though, he wasn't interested, and he went back to school. He went to Full Sail University. And so I guess that's where that ties in early on to this. He went well, first he had gone to another school for networking. Is that what it's called? Were you like computer oriented networking?
Yeah, yeah. IT, like information technology, yeah. Stuff like that. Yeah.
Yeah, that wasn't enough. So he went to Full Sail after bumming around, you know, living at home with mom and dad for a little while, saying, I can't get a job with this. He went to school to Full Sail for game development. He came out of the other end making real good money, and so he went into game development. I think he was working more with simulations that were training people to do things rather than games, like at home games. But he was making good money. Me, I was still squandering. I tried to do my painting business thing. I jumped in. I actually did that for about 8 years.
Oh, wow.
8 years. And I, my brother was already living his dream. And then he was going to work during the 9-to-5, but he was still making good money. So I was my own boss, but I wasn't a very good boss because I had me working 24 hours a day. Yeah. And either I was working or I was put on leave because I didn't know where my next client was coming from. Because I would spend all my time, you know, painting the houses, and there was no marketing working for me. There was nothing, you know, I had tried advertising in the paper and stuff like that. It just, you know, I just had no idea what I was doing. And so I would have phases. I'd be working on something. I'd, you know, get my paycheck, so to speak. And then I'd be knocking door to door, handing people my flyers for, can I paint your house kind of thing. It was pathetic. It was, but then that went on, you know, different cycles, different variations of that for 8 years. And we moved out here to Georgia. We moved around before that, Pennsylvania, California, moved out here to Georgia. My wife was working this whole time. When we came out here to Georgia, we had our second baby on the way. Our first one was barely a year old, a little over than a year old. We had our second baby on the way. And I'm still going through this cycle. And I'm like, something's got to change. You know, I'm feeling it's, you know, a lot of people probably would have said it's too late to go back to school. It's too late to change anything. And I was going to go back in for where I started, which was art. And I looked at Full Sail because that's where my brother went. Mm-hmm. Younger brother, by the way. I looked at Full Sail. I was like, I'm going to see what they got, you know, art wise and get back into that, because this climbing around on houses all day in the Georgia heat is not for me.
I'd imagine.
It's not for me. And, you know, I wanted to start going towards that dream. It would have still been a long time till I get to where I am now, but I called him up. I was thinking about the graphic design program there, and then I found the marketing program. And with my history with my brother of having done the website thing, mm-hmm. and some of our crazy get-rich-quick ideas that we had, the marketing thing really appealed to me, and I thought to myself, you know, I could be real creative there. You know, I don't really know what this is or what it's about, but, you know, I always had thoughts of there's all different kinds of creativity in artwork, from music to graphic design to movies, perhaps commercials. And I just had this idea in my head that, you know, maybe it could be a mixture of all those things when I get into marketing. I don't really know where this road leads. And two things will happen. I'll either use what I learned there to make my painting business succeed, and I could start doing that right away. So when I signed up, I was wanting to learn now so I could apply stuff now to my painting business. And so I said, I'm either going to make that succeed, or, you know, the fallback plan is I'll have a degree and, you know, I'll be able to get a marketing job, so to speak. So that's what, and that's just the beginning. That's where I started. That happened in 2010.
Great minds think alike. Yeah, that's more or less my story as well. I meandered the interwebs, and same thought as you. I'll use this and apply it for myself, and push comes to shove, I'll get a job. Cool. So if you could go back in time and talk to your younger self, you know, without causing any paradoxes or cataclysms to the space-time continuum, what top three lessons would you tell yourself about your career? Because, you know, we're both men of a certain age. We're older millennials. We're fresh out of 20s, right? If you could go back and talk to your 22-year-old self, you know, what top three things would you tell yourself?
Well, knowing what I know now, I would start in marketing right away because it's diverse, because I was entrepreneurial, I had that entrepreneurial spirit, and you know, you're not going to, if you're an entrepreneur, if you want to have your own business, if you want to do anything in that category, then you have to do marketing. There's no way around it, especially if you're a one-man show. You're not going to succeed without the marketing knowledge. So I would just say to get into that as early as possible, no matter what road it ended up going down, like a job or work for yourself or start a company or whatever. Marketing is pretty much the key knowledge base that it all hinges on in order for you to succeed in any one of those areas. So I would say just get an early start in that. Even though marketing, internet marketing especially, looks a whole lot different today than it did back then, it still would have been good foundationally to start learning all that stuff. So, and I don't know if I divided that into three
that was
lessons.
One. Yeah. Let me get two more.
So, it would be that. I would say, in line with all of those things, to be starting services and just applying what I know as I go right away, instead of trying to learn everything up front and then apply it later. I would still say go to school, but I would tell myself and anybody else who's listening to this also, you know, for me, school was the right choice, and I guess we're going to get into that later too. But I would say you're still not going to avoid the school of hard knocks. You can go to school, and there's lots of benefits. We'll probably get into that. But you need to have this whole other side, this continual education on your own, this hunger, this thirst for knowledge and applying that knowledge day in and day out, constantly, because nobody else is ever going to shove that all in your head through osmosis, you know? It's going to be something that you have to dig and apply constantly. And so the sooner you can get started doing that, the better.
Absolutely. And the only thing I would add from my end is I would have learned how to code, because I don't know, like, I know enough, like, if somebody stuck a gun out and said, you know, hyperlink this or I'll kill you, I could do the hrefs equal and all that. But I would have learned how to code because a guy I follow, Mike King, he does a lot with SEO Moz, and he spoke at Moz Con, and he's friends with Rand Fishkin and blah, blah. That was his path. He knew how to code, and because he knew how to code, he got dubbed the tech guy. And so everything else that fell down the line kind of fell in his lap, so to speak. So even though that wasn't, you know, technically what he did, he kind of got shoved in that arena just because he had some form of familiarity with it. And coding is just an all-around good skill to have. So awesome. In the last 3 months of the 2016 U.S. presidential election, fake news outperformed real news on Facebook. Now, don't worry. This is a podcast about marketing, not politics. But what I'm trying to pull out with that example is that most people can't call BS online when they see it. Now, this is in stark contrast to the whole un-college movement that favors finding information online, oftentimes for free, as opposed to paying for higher education. Now, that tactic can work, assuming you can call BS when you see it, which unfortunately most people just can't. The ability to call BS online, what we call digital discernment, is a skill, which means that it can be learned. Go to bit.ly.com/DMD course to learn the skill of digital discernment. In this short course, taught by yours truly, I condense my over a decade of trial and error experience, as well as the skill I learned getting a degree in digital marketing for your benefit. Go to bit.ly.com/DMD course right now. That's bit.ly/D as in dog, M as in Mary, D as in dog course. So cool. So in terms of benefits from going to full sale, because, you know, there's sort of two schools of thought, right? There's the just Google it school of thought, and a degree doesn't get you anything but debt, and you're a lot better just, you know, taking online courses. And then, of course, you can do what we did. So just sort of address that head on, as you alluded to, in terms of hard benefits to full sale, as opposed to, you know, rolling the dice on Google. In your own words, for your benefit, you know, what did you get out of the deal?
Yeah, so I could be really real on all this. And this is, I can only speak to my own experience, not anybody else's. So school in general, I would say, does a couple of things. It lets other people know, and yourself know too, because it's a self-confidence thing, that you can commit to something and finish it. Mm-hmm. This school in particular, I don't know about all schools, but it really upped my game as far as meeting deadlines, because it was a very fast-paced program. You had that midnight, it wasn't supposed to be a midnight deadline. I mean, you're supposed to get it done before that. But for most of us, we're like, oh man, I got to put 4 hours in starting now to meet that deadline. And then, I mean,
11:59 p.m. I did that a couple of times.
Nothing teaches you more about giving yourself that, you know, that head start, that cushion, because then you got upload times, right? So it's like, but I was done, but it didn't upload in time, right? And then you got, this is one thing I learned the hard way, and it was because of school that taught me. I was doing everything. I have a Mac computer that's part of the program, that you get the lunchbox deal thing at the time. At least that was at the time. I don't know about it anymore. But so I got I had running the MacBook computer, doing my homework on that inside of Microsoft programs, inside of Word, inside of PowerPoint, right? The number of times that Microsoft software crashed and lost everything I was working on for the past 4 hours, I could cry every time. And that got me moved into doing everything in Google Docs. Still to this day, everything is done in Google Docs. Everything. And every time somebody sends me a Word document, I'm like, look, stop doing that. Don't send me a Word document. You got to get on Google Docs. So that's another little nugget for people out there. It saves it for you. No worries. There's nothing that Google Docs can't do that I need to do as far as business and all that. So I would say the deadlines, the writing, the self-confidence, and to show other people and employers too. If you're talking about future employers, look, I went somewhere, got a degree. I completed it. You know, I can do a commitment, I can finish things, I can meet deadlines, I can do all those things. So that's, school in general does that for you. Somebody say one time, the quote that stuck in my head is that people who pay attention.
Right.
People who pay attention. You put your money down, I know it's just a loan, right? But you're going to pay that loan back. I'm still paying the loan back. You put your money down, you're thinking to yourself, well, I better pay attention. And I better figure out how I'm going to use this. And it sort of makes you to be committed. Otherwise, you know, people in human nature, you go off, you could be determined, you could be entrepreneurial, you could hustle, and you don't have to have school. But I know myself, I would have dug into it for a few months, got sidetracked, dug into here for a few months, got sidetracked. I would have went round and round and round in circles. And in the back of my mind, also, I would have always thought, you know, I would have had this discounting thought to myself that you really don't know what you're doing, you're a fraud, you don't really know how this works, you know, because, you know, there's certifications and stuff that you could get, and you could look up stuff all day long. You can go through the school of hard knocks, but there would have always been this thing in the back of my mind. And so I think having seen what it's like from the inside of a university and what they teach and what the standards are, I had that as sort of a measuring stick. And it got rid of all that stuff mentally for me. It motivated me mentally. And it was at that same time that I actually started that learning for myself. So outside of the school, I was listening to podcast after podcast. I was books, videos, researching people, studying copywriting. I was, during the whole time, I was doing all that for myself. Mm-hmm. And I would even say that I brought most of that material to my classroom and to my assignments. It wasn't really like the education was coming to me and then I learned it and then I applied it outside. It was all this learning I was doing on my – and maybe just because that's my personality and I was – and that's, I learn better when I'm excited about a topic and I go for it. Mm-hmm. But I was kind of bringing that into my assignments. But then again, I had the assignments that gave it a structure that provided me that baseline, that guide. Deadlines, once again, having to write it out or build a web page or do the projects, mm-hmm. right, throughout the whole thing. So it gave me that guide, it gave me that baseline alongside of what my own learning was. Right. And I probably rambled on long enough about that. The hard benefits, though, mm-hmm. the hard benefits, and we can go, you can stop me at any time.
No, go for it. No, this is what we came here for.
So people want to know, was it really worth it? So all that stuff I said so far, someone who hasn't gone to school yet or somebody who's a bit younger might not really understand the actual value of all the things I just said. Uh-huh. Like, yeah, so what? I could, you know, from what you said, I could just go and do it. You can, but yeah, you don't really at a younger age, I don't think you really know yourself well enough to be able to do that, and I mean some do, some have, but for me it wouldn't have worked. And amen. I didn't know that at the time. I only know that now.
Amen, brother. I'm telling you,
I only know that now. And I'll say, when I graduated, I had the degree. Before I even graduated, I had a job locally as a marketing manager. Boom, bingo. Before, I was like, I'm going to have a degree specifically in internet marketing, which was a big thing. Mm-hmm. Nobody in my area was applying to a job or the same jobs as me that had that degree. They might have had a business degree. They might have had, you know, communications or something like that. But they did not have a degree specifically in internet marketing. And the businesses that I was going after – since I was all – they were looking for a marketing professional. They wanted people to handle the website and social media and all that kind of stuff, is primarily internet-based stuff. And so I had a specialty in that, and so it helped me stand out. So for over the course of three local jobs, that degree helped me to stand out, and I was able to get those jobs. Now, ultimately, those jobs were this is a small town. They didn't pay enough for me to support my family of four. Uh-huh. And also, I got really bored in them really quickly, just again, because of my personality and my entrepreneurial tendencies, that I had to move on. When a lot of these folks weren't really applying what I was, you know, the plans and the ideas that I had for them, they could see it on my face. They were like, you don't seem happy. I'm like, I'm not. Why am I here? So, in one sense, they were not exactly what I was after. But, you know, those jobs needed to happen. Uh-huh. Those jobs needed to happen. School needed to happen. I didn't avoid the school of hard knocks. I still had to pay for school, and I had to do the hard knocks. And I had to have these jobs that were not ideal, because you don't just start at the top.
Absolutely.
Right. And so when I went to get my own clients, I started to learn really about, you know, what could separate me. My phone's going off. I got to toss it over there in a pile of laundry over there. What's going to separate me from all these other internet marketing professionals that were out there? And it seemed to be like everybody at this stage, it was like everybody's trying to be an entrepreneur. Everybody's online. Everybody can do marketing services. Everybody's a social media manager. Everybody, and it's just like so clouded and so dark. So I went to try to get clients for myself, and it was like, no, wait, look, I have a degree in this. And they're like, it perked their interest up a little bit, right? Mm-hmm. So this was just clients. This would be like a local roofing contractor or a local plumber, or and they'd be like, okay, that's more valid. And like, look, I was a marketing manager at this local place, and I was a marketing director at this local place, and I was able to state these things, you know, marketing manager, marketing director, even though they weren't the ideal job for me, I was able to sort of build a resume, and I had, you know, both my knowledge and experience from what I've studied and learned myself, and an official document saying that I knew internet marketing, and then official jobs, local jobs, real jobs. So when I came into the online space, also to try to find clients, they were looking for somebody that was a little bit more grounded like that, or, you know, just the fact that I was more grounded, you know, I worked in the real world. And it's just a mindset. This mindset might go away, you know, 10 years down the track. But at the time, when I was looking for these clients, or when I was pitching to them and justifying myself as a service provider that they needed, it was these types of things that made me stand out from the competition.
Absolutely. And just to expound on what you said a little bit back about those things needing to happen in your journey. So Full Sail is an accelerated degree program, meaning that you're going to complete a four-year degree in about 30 months. Now, what that means is that they're going to take an entire 15-week semester and condense it down into 4 weeks, right? When I was younger, I'd have flunked out. Like, there's no way I'd have been able to meet that pace. And because of that accelerated pace, they necessarily can't go deep in a lot of topics. Like, you're going to get the software, you're going to get Adobe Creative Suite, but they're not going to spend 2 weeks teaching you Photoshop. Like, there's just no time. They have to get through a 15-week semester in 4 weeks. So absolutely what you said about the journey needing to happen, you needing to mature, and then also you latching on to something and then going for it. You got to have that, because if you come in thinking, okay, I'm just going to fall back and teach whatever, like, that degree program will chew you up and spit you out. It really will, because you saw me nodding my head and laughing, like, I've met that 11:59 p.m. deadline. And you don't plan it that way, but it's like, it's a lot to do, and you got load times and etc. So that was awesome. Yep. Man, thanks for sharing that. So two last questions, and then we'll wrap up, let you get back to your day. So, and this is gonna be a fun one. So you, Gary V, Tim Ferriss are all chilling at the bar after a conference, and you're having a no BS straight talk mini mastermind, right? What would you say is severely lacking in the professional digital marketing space right now, and how would you brainstorm about correcting it?
That's tough. And we have, you know, in that mix that you just described there, I know Gary Vaynerchuk is all about the school system is broken, mm-hmm. right? And so he addresses what you just said in that way. And he's got his own solutions. And if you follow Gary Vee, you probably know what they are. But you know, I would say that the school that I went to is a little bit different in the fact that it's not, I live in a university town here. It's one of the oldest universities. They got business schools. They got all that. And what is typically taught in those kind of programs from a traditional marketing, standpoint, from a branding overall standpoint, It's not preparing you. It's still a classroom structure kind of thing. Where I went to school at Full Sail University, we have instructors that that are practicing what they're teaching, right? They're currently practicing what they're teaching. It's not somebody who couldn't make it, so they became a professor. Like in a lot of cases that you get, they say those who can't teach. These are people who are practicing and they teach. So they have their own businesses or they're entrepreneurial or whatever. And so there's that element to it. And the fact that, you know, the program, as far as how I went to it, I did it all online, right? To me, that was a very important element to help prepare me for what I wanted to do, which is work remotely. Because I had moved all over with my painting business and I didn't want to, you know, I didn't want to start over anymore. I started my business in Pennsylvania. I started over when I went to California. I started over when I came out here to Georgia. And it was constantly like starting over to have that kind of a business. And I just wanted something where I could travel, I could move, I could do whatever. It's not going to affect anything. And so Full Sail prepared me to do that because everything's remote. Everything's remote. You did it online, turned your homework online. It showed you how to communicate better online, you know, with other students, with the teachers, find what you need online. And that's exactly what I do now in my job, right? Everything's online. I turn things in online. I have phone calls or Skype calls like this, talk to clients or whoever, and everything's online and it's remote. So it prepared me to do that. In the marketing world, I would say education wise, I think a lot of other schools need to take a note from Full Sail to prepare students for, you know, what it is that they really want or what the real world is or what it's going towards, as opposed to trying to prepare them for the old model, which seems to be what a lot of schools are doing these days as far as marketing goes. Yeah, and what was the rest of the question?
No, that was it. You nailed it. Like what do you see that's wrong with the professional marketing space, and how would you go about correcting it? And like you just said, a lot of schools need to take a page from Full Sail. And of course, I'm a little bit biased, but I tend to agree, because and that's what's wrong with a lot of people's thinking, because they're thinking, like you said, those who can't teach and all this other old world stuff. And it's like, it's 2016, folks. Like that cliche stopped being true a while ago. But yeah, it's cool. So last question, and this one's going to be a doozy. It's a modified version of the last question that John Lee Dumas asked, but I'm going to set you up as to why I'm asking it, because in my personal opinion, this is my opinion, there's a gap in the professional digital marketing education space in terms of career trajectory. And by professional, I mean someone who works in-house at a brand or a corporation, or works at an agency like yourself, either virtual or in person. Because, you know, just in terms of journey, you know, like you said, we kind of meander around the Googles for a while, and then, but there's no guarantee there, right? You might end up on lynda.com or Udemy. You might end up in Amway. Like, who knows, right? And so after you do that for a little bit, you get serious and you go to college. But, you know, a lot of folks are in a life situation where they can't do that. You know, it was very expensive. You know, had to borrow the better part of 60 grand. And then it was also time consuming. Even though it's accelerated, it was still 30 months. It was still 2.5 years. And so the vast majority of the way that people do that, because, you know, we're a distinct minority, but most folks, they go to conferences. The problem with conferences is that even though in aggregate it's a lot cheaper than going to Full Sail, you have to have that money up front, right? They don't take financial aid. So take a South by Southwest or a ClickFunnels or, you know, a MozCon or something like that. You're talking, you know, anywhere from $500 to $1,500 just to get in the door. That doesn't include your flight, your hotel, Uber back and forth, eating out for however many days. You add all that stuff back in, and you're looking at like $3,000 to $5,000 for a weekend. And then typically at like a ClickFunnels or something like that, they're going to have this VIP coaching program for an additional $10,000 or $15,000. And so out of pocket, you're looking at, you know, 15, 20 grand with no financial aid. So like there's a gap there that I'm trying to address. So now that I just rambled for all that time, I'll get to the actual question. Okay. Imagine you woke up in a brand new world, identical to Earth, but you knew no one. You still have all the experience, skills, and knowledge you currently have, your food and shelter taken care of, but all you have is a laptop and no money. That's right, you are college freshman broke, baby. You got somewhere to lay your head, a meal plan, computer Wi-Fi, and that's it. How would you form relationships with industry thought leaders over the next 30 days by working for free?
Okay, so I get on that laptop. I'd find the thought leaders. Most of them have communities or groups. I'd join these communities or groups. I'd watch them for a little bit, maybe a couple weeks, figure out what is their school of thought, what is it that they do, provide for the group, what's the vocabulary, you know, really start to understand who are the key players in this, you know, in this group. In this other world, is online space still generally the same?
Everything's the same. You just don't know anybody.
Okay. And join this group. And then I would begin to slowly, you got to ease into it, answer some questions in the group wherever I can. Someone's having a struggle with this. Pop on there and answer. Give your best advice. Someone's having a struggle with this. Pop on there. Give an answer. Give your best advice. Then start doing some of your own posting for some more. Hopefully this can help somebody. Don't ever pitch yourself. Don't ever sell yourself. Just get on there and start adding value. I'm going to teach everybody this. I hope somebody finds it useful. Ask me questions. I'll help you. That kind of thing. Do that for a little bit. Then, you know, I would try to make a more specific connection with the moderator of that group. The one who's running the show, make a connection with them, private message kind of thing, just saying hi at first. What you want to do there is find out generally what they're doing in their business and look for little holes or things or gaps where you could help. And then don't ask them, just do it. Just do it. So I did this a little bit in a group. I was in a few groups just over a year ago now. A lot's changed over the past year to be to where I am today. And I started doing everything I just said. I connected with the guy, and I saw that he could use some graphic design. So graphic design was one of my skill sets. I started doing that and just giving it to him. Like, hey, I saw that you need XYZ. Here, I've done one for you. You know, take it or leave it kind of thing, whatever you want. Then he started in his group, whenever somebody would ask a question pertaining to like graphic design, for example, he would say, Chris does great graphic design. Right. And there it starts. There it starts the roller coaster. Yeah, sure, I'll be happy to talk to you. And then I start charging those people. And then, you know, as relationship grew, he saw me as a helpful, trustworthy, non-spammer guy, right, who really authentically wanted to help people. He eventually came to know that I do more than graphic design. And it was him who actually recommended me, and this was sort of an inner circle, right? He recommended me to somebody who was hiring for the position that I'm in now. So it was through that communication that I landed this job that is remote, that pays me enough salary to have a house here in the country and two cars and a family of four. Like I said, my wife works too, but she makes less than I do. She's a professional sign language interpreter working for a school district. And I finally, in our life, make more than, after 13 years, make more than what she does. After all that trying and trying and trying, finally in that spot. And so it was through that methodology, right? Going into a group, Don't go in like a know-it-all. Watch, wait, learn, listen. Be helpful just by answering questions that are being asked. Then start presenting your own information. Then start connecting with the people that are in charge, moderators of that those groups. And then just give. Don't ask, hey, what can I do for you? That's not going to work. You look, pay attention, identify what they're after, and just give it to them.
Awesome. That is amazing. Thank you for that. That strategy. I'm telling you, it works. Look at Chris. He's living the dream. It works. So, Chris, man, this has been awesome. Where can people get in contact with you online? Where can they follow you on Twitter? If you have any courses or products or Facebook groups, let us know how to get a hold of you, man.
So we're on the topic of groups here. You can actually find my group if you go to Facebook and search for a group called Funnel Architects. That's my group. About 1,100 some people in there now. That's been over a year or so building. I'm still not selling anything in there. I'm still just building. I'm biding my time. I'm cultivating a community. You're welcome to come join if you're interested in that type of thing as far as marketing funnels, marketing strategy. Come join that group. You can find me at goodrow.com. The name will probably be in the show notes somewhere. It's not spelt at all like it sounds, but it's my last name.com. I'm going to have a personal brand page up, and that's where you can learn more about me.
Awesome. And I can tell you the guy practices what he preaches in that group is awesome. I'm in it. I like all the videos. I participate, and it really is the place to be. So, Mr. Christopher Gaudreau, thank you so much for your time. I greatly appreciate it.
Thanks. I hope it helped. School is not the only way to go, but I certainly, like we've covered here, I wouldn't discount it in any way. It's added a lot of value to me. It continues to do so. It's something that I'm proud of. And again, it's up to everybody individually, right?
Absolutely. What he said. Have you ever been paralyzed while doing research? You go to Google, you type in your search query, and seconds later you're hit with millions, if not billions, of search results, and you can't make heads or tails out of any of them. Overwhelmed and afraid you'll make the wrong choice, you don't make any choice at all. Well, friends, you're not alone, but you needn't suffer in silence. The ability to make sense out of what you find online, and more importantly, call BS when you see it, is a skill, which means that it can be learned. Go to bit.ly.com/DMD course right now to learn the skill of digital discernment. In this short course, taught by yours truly, I condense my over a decade of trial and error experience, as well as what I've learned getting a degree in internet marketing for your benefit. Go to bit.ly.com/D as in dog, M as in Mary, D as in dog course. One more time, bit.ly.com/DMD course. Thank you for doing me the high honor of listening to the very end. Please subscribe in iTunes, Stitcher, or your favorite podcasting app. Leave a 5-star rating and write a review telling people about my unmitigated awesomeness. It really helps out with getting the show shown. Follow me on Twitter at Tembo8482. That's TEMB8482. Or connect on LinkedIn, and I'll have my LinkedIn description in the show notes. And I'll see you next week.